Blackstone Audiobooks and the Hollywood Theatre of the Year present Elizabeth Montgomery, George Grizzard, and Sir Nigel Hawthorne in a production of the American Dialogues Foundation, Craven Street, Ben Franklin in London. Welcome. I'm Robert Foxworth, executive producer of Craven Street. Before the curtain rises, I think a brief introduction is in order. "What say you to your friend and brother philosopher Franklin?" asked Edmund Burke in 1775, who at upwards of 70 years of age quits the study of the laws of nature in order to give laws to new commonwealths, and has crossed the Atlantic Ocean at that time of life, not to seek repose, but to plunge into the midst of the most laborious and most arduous affairs that ever were. When Burke made that remark, Franklin was leaving London after an eventful, occasionally harrowing 10 years' sojourn, during which America and Great Britain hazarded those steps that led to the Revolution. In fact, the shot heard round the world smote the air at Lexington while Franklin was still on the sea. He had entered London's public arena an Englishman, discovered himself an American, and departed a revolutionary. The play he acted and co-authored is full of incident, humor, sentiment, suspense, intrigue, and confrontation mounted against the spectacle of international power politics. His countrymen cast him as a colonial agent, remote from power, unrepresented in Parliament, and clashing with British policy, royal officials, and the proprietors of land-grant provinces, colonial assemblies had been employing agents to represent them in London since the 1620s. The agents lobbied, negotiated, bribed influential functionaries, kept constituents informed, propagandized, and walked official papers through Whitehall's labyrinthine bureaucracies. Some agents were English merchants, others MPs like Burke. Only a few were colonials, men of disparate abilities, experience, energy, and motivation. As Pennsylvania agent, Franklin had already spent 5 heady years in London, 1757 to 1762, with his son William. That trip had given him his first taste of cosmopolitan Europe as a man of substance. He had come over once many years before as a young, obscure, and impoverished printer's devil. Poor Richard, and especially his electrical experiments, had made him a favorite of dissenters, radicals, and philosophers, the most stimulating and liberal minds of the day. His well-situated rooms in Craven Street, near Whitehall and his favorite coffee houses, were superintended by the devoted widow Margaret Stevenson and her ingenious daughter, Mary, nicknamed Polly, whom Franklin took unto himself as a second family. He enjoyed some success with his official mission, saw his son matriculated from the Middle Temple and appointed Royal Governor of New Jersey, struck many important friendships, received honorary degrees from St. Andrews and Oxford, caused a stir with a new musical invention, became an influential member of the Society of Arts and the Royal Society, and generally fueled his prestige and influence with liberal doses of personal charm. In America, he had been a big fish in a provincial pond and was now swimming confidently in the great ocean, beloved and honored by the intellectuals who mattered most to him. Thus he found England most commodious and was reluctant to leave. Quote, "Why should not the valuable North American plants flourish here?" as Polly suggested in 1762. Before embarking for home, he resolved to return. Quote, "The attraction of reason," he said, "is at present for the other side of the water, but that of inclination will be for this side, you know, which usually prevails. I shall probably make but this one vibration and settle here forever." He estimated that he would be back in 2 years, quote, "provided we can persuade the good woman to cross the seas." The good woman, his wife Deborah, refused to make the perilous crossing. Not otherwise devoid of courage, she was terrified of the sea. The written evidence suggests she was a sturdy, stubborn, practical, and hard-working tradesman's wife, loyal to her husband, devoted to her family, but barely literate and unintellectual. In her mid-50s in 1764, when her husband was urging her to cross the ocean with him, she may have surmised that, were she to leave, she would never return, and refused to give up Philadelphia, her only home, for alien London, where she would cut an awkward figure. Perhaps realizing that if he made a second crossing she might lose him, she persuaded him to begin construction of a new house, either as an inducement or as a symbol of his promised return.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.